Our personal priorities may transform as we age. Needs and wants can change as we turn the page. We all might prefer to pilot a well-planned destiny. Unforeseen circumstances alter almost any strategy.
Phyllis and I had built a very successful graphic design business, and we had purposely kept it small by selectively accepting customers and projects that we could manage with minimal infrastructure. Phyllis focused on the creative, and I handled the aspects that employed the emerging computer-assisted design technology. It was exciting and challenging to be involved in an ever-evolving creative environment that often meant interfacing with youthful people. In the group I supervised, there was rarely more than 5 to 6 people, and due to the nature of the business, there was a fairly high rate of turnover. To keep up with the latest in the world of computer-assisted design, I would attend an annual trade show in Las Vegas, and usually bring along a couple from my group. On the evening of the third day of the show, I convened an informal session in the hotel lounge to review what we had learned and plan our activities for the remainder of the show. As our business wound down, along with a couple of cocktails, the 2 20-something women that I had brought with me expressed a desire to take in a show and do some bar hopping. Having reached my early 50s, I knew that regardless of my willingness to participate, I was sure that I would only weigh them down and politely declined their enthusiastic offer to join them. As they departed, my modest goal was to finish my drink, adjourn to my room, and take a little TV and sleep until the rooster crowed. The overwhelming charm of his approach squashed my potential resistance. He had touched my arm as he introduced himself while smoothly occupying a chair just vacated by one of my colleagues. Before I could question his interest in my middle-aged business matron, while available young women were strewn throughout the lounge, he placed his hand over mine and announced, "I'm always at a loss when the young guys take off to go bar hopping." His smile as he punctuated his proclamation was completely disarming, and he continued with a brief explanation of what he was doing at the trade show. He had already positioned himself as a kindred spirit before I had an opportunity to meekly respond in agreement with his assessment of our common circumstances. I no longer saw my drink as an obstacle to retreating to my room and quickly agreed to his offer to get us another round.
The day, the place, the moment, the excitement, cut loose in joy, who cares where caution went?
I seized the opportunity provided by his trip to the bar to run to the washroom and try to quickly pull myself together. Given a significant line at the bar, I got back to the table before he returned. Watching him walking back to the table in a confident gait, dressed beyond a typical sales representative, well-coiffed head of hair and matching salt and pepper beard, and closely trimmed beard and mustache, doubt once again began welling up as my confidence evaporated. He immediately distracted me from negative thoughts by surprising me with a series of questions about our company and my role, where he seemed to demonstrate significant knowledge about the business. I hadn't enjoyed the social situation and being so excited by someone's company in decades. But about halfway through my drink, I began to feel very tired and wearily apologized that I simply had to depart from my room. He showed immediate understanding and insisted that he escort me up the elevator. By the time we arrived at my door, I had become somewhat disoriented and do not remember that he must have helped me right into the bed. As I slowly regained consciousness, I also slowly became aware of my grave circumstances. My ankles and wrists were all firmly handcuffed, and I was stretched spread-eagled on a bed, and it was not in my room. Tape had been securely fastened over my mouth, preventing any vocalizing, and I was completely naked. Out of general confusion, I was experiencing a plethora of emotions and seemed to be competing for my awareness. Fear, anger, humiliation, disgust, despair, all took their turn as realization crystallized through my awakening senses. I could feel some soreness in my crotch area and suspected that he'd already been busy. But when he noticed that I was gaining consciousness, he began in earnest with a running commentary describing each salacious activity in cruel detail.
What possible perverse satisfaction may be gained, taking another's freedom and inflicting such pain? Is the recognition of self without considering another? Where did he come from? Could he have a real mother?
After hours of enduring his continuous assault, I'd collapsed into an overwhelming feeling of helplessness, and I could no longer visualize the wonderful things in my life in an attempt to sublimate what was being done to me. As tears welled up in my eyes and began to roll down my face uncontrollably, he seemed to finally begin to lose his enthusiasm. Suddenly he stepped away from the bed, and when he returned, his face held a very stern look, and he pulled out a pair of leather gloves. I had seen his face, and I suspected that he would not risk any future testimony. I thought about my family and resigned myself to imminent death. Then this monster proceeded to thank me for being a gracious hostess, that he had enjoyed himself immensely, and announced that he had a parting gift. The last thing I eventually remembered was him raising his glove fist before smashing it into my face.
It seems that your memory was part of his goal, brutal and lasting insidious attack on your soul.
Apparently, I was discovered early the next day by the cleaning staff, still unconscious. I spent a couple of weeks recuperating in the Las Vegas hospital before I was stable enough to be flown home. I was recovering from a hairline fracture of my skull and a serious concussion, along with several broken bones in my face. I had no other significant injuries on my body. In the next few weeks, I became well acquainted with a plastic surgeon and a psychiatrist. After only a few sessions, the psychiatrist proclaimed that I seemed to be handling the trauma quite effectively, and he did not feel that more therapy was required. He did, however, recommend a victims group that might offer some further help. The face reconstruction, on the other hand, proved to be a more long-term proposition. Apparently, the excellent care provided by the trauma surgeons in Las Vegas mitigated the issues, but I still faced two or three operations in the coming months to deal with cosmetic issues. 5 weeks after returning home, I received a call from the detective with the Las Vegas Police Department, who had been assigned to my case. Upon assurance that I was ready to discuss the matter, we settled on a date for him to come for an interview. With some prodding from Mike, most of the interview was spent with me recounting what I remembered of the incident. He was impressed with the detail that I provided, but given my improving memory, we agreed that a follow-up interview might be useful. He also assured me that all available evidence indicated that I had been the victim of a skilled and very experienced predator, and that there would have been little that I could have done to avoid the incident. This helped me a lot to relieve my feelings of guilt and shame that my own foolishness may have been largely responsible. He also promised to keep me up to date on any developments in the case. Following the interview, Mike called me several times with updates, and our relationship began to evolve into a friendship. Mike was a couple of years older than me and had lost his wife to cancer several years earlier. We exchanged email addresses and romance ensued. In conjunction with our follow-up interview, we also planned a dinner and an evening on the town. That night, Mike invited me to Las Vegas to attend his upcoming retirement party. It was scheduled a few weeks after the last cosmetic surgery for my face. The happy irony was that the cosmetic procedures had left me looking about 10 years younger than before the incident. I was so excited to show off my improved face to Mike, and he seemed equally excited to introduce me to all his friends at the party. Given the obvious love and respect shown to Mike by his colleagues at the event, I felt so grateful that I'd stumbled on such a wonderful man. On the way back to his apartment, he asked if I would mind a stop at his favorite all-night cafe for coffee. After the waitress left our drinks, he pulled a small box from his jacket, produced a beautiful diamond ring, and simply said, "Will you marry me?" I immediately responded yes. Before I could ask about the practicality of the arrangement, he assured me that his job was all that kept him in Las Vegas, and he would be eager to relocate. A couple of weeks after Mike arrived and directly joined me at my apartment. A short time after, Mike landed a job as a security consultant with a major corporation, and we began planning our wedding. Life had afforded us both a second chance at happiness.
Lemons and Lemonade offers too weak a comparison. Your strength and resilience went beyond correlation. We were eager to know if your attacker faced justice, that he could no longer threaten others amongst us.
A couple of years after my assault, Mike received a phone call from one of his former colleagues. Apparently, they had captured a rapist dead to rights in a sting operation. He eventually confessed to several rape assaults in three different jurisdictions. The details that he provided for one incident corresponded close enough to those in my written statement to satisfy the investigators that I was the victim. Mike's friend indicated that the circumstances would result in a sentence of life without parole. Some of the other victims had expressed a desire to make a statement at the final court appearance, but I firmly declined. I had no desire to relive the incident or see him again.
Amen, amen.
I walked into this empty church. I had no place else to go. When the sweetest voice I ever heard whispered to my soul, I don't need to be forgiven for loving you so much. It's written in the scriptures. It's written there in blood. I even heard the